Hi, my name is Jenny Binzley, and I'm a lecturer here for an Introduction to Engineering Design course in the College of Engineering. And today I'm going to give a brief introduction to a widely used engineering tool called failure mode effect analysis. And for the remainder of this talk, I'm going to refer to failure mode effect analysis as FMEA. I'll start by describing what FMEA is and why it's important. I'll then give a brief summary of the historical development of this tool. I'll talk about how this tool is used in industry and the basic steps that FMEA team may follow. And finally, I'll touch on some of the pitfalls and limitations that are common with the FMEA tool. So what is FMEA? Failure mode effect analysis is a tool for identifying potential problems or failures with a design early in the design process and evaluating the risk having to do with those failures. And the FMEA process is an especially useful engineering tool because the FMEA team actually calculates a number associated with the cause of a failure mode, allowing the team then to prioritize the risk factors that need to be, and identify the risk factors that need to be eliminated or lessened before that product could go into production. So the idea behind FMEA is nothing new. Engineers have always assessed risk having to do with design. However, if you think back in history to the mid-20th century, engineers were working on historically large, expensive projects, particularly in the military and the space program. And it wasn't feasible, either cost-wise or time-wise, to rely on physical models or to rely on testing to really understand failures in design. So the military formalized this process called failure mode effect analysis in the mid-50s, and it was adopted by aerospace in the 60s and the automotive industry in the 70s and 80s. Since then, the benefits, the expanded benefits of failure mode effect analysis have been recognized across many industries. And these expanded benefits include reduced product development cycles, improved customer satisfaction, reduced warranty costs, and reduced safety recalls. So with these being recognized, a wide variety of industries have adopted FMEAs into their product development cycles. And it's used in industries from aerospace and automotive to healthcare, semiconductor processing, and food service. So it's used all over the place. And also the focus of FMEAs has expanded beyond just looking at design to different aspects of the product development cycle, including manufacturing processes, software, and service. So who does an FMEA and what steps do they follow? In my experience in industry, an FMEA team is put together of about a half dozen people. And that team then is led by a quality engineer or a performance engineer. And ideally, the teams have a broad perspective on the product. And they also come from a variety of experience levels. So team members may include engineers, technicians, manufacturing personnel, people in marketing, or even customers. And following this formalized FMEA process helps those involved in the design process think about their design differently. So instead of concentrating on how does the design meet a particular customer requirement, or how does it fit into the product development specification, it forces the team to concentrate on the design weaknesses or how that design could fail. It also helps the team think about that design through the anticipated life of the product that's being designed, and it encourages them to think about all the ways in which the product may be used that maybe it wasn't initially intended for. So now I'm going to go through the basic steps that FMEA team would go through. And I want to point out that I've included an example of a partial FMEA on a bicycle that after this talk, if you go through the if you download the example and go through it, it can help you really understand the steps. So the first step that the team needs to go through is to make sure everyone understands the design configuration. Next, the team brainstorms all the ways that the system could fail. And we refer to this as failure modes. Third, for each failure mode, the team identifies the effect of that failure on the component that fails, the system, and the end user. And it will brainstorm all the potential root causes that could lead to that failure. And I want to note that there could be many causes for a particular failure. So let's think about the bicycle. A failure for the bicycle could be that the rear brake does not work, that the brake pad does not come in contact with the wheel. There are numerous causes that could cause that brake not to work. So that they'll then come up with the causes for the failure. Next, the group is going to go through an exercise to quantify the risk. And there are three values that the team defines, there's three values that the team is going to define in order to quantify that risk for a failure mode and the cause of that failure. And then each of these values will be ranked from 1 to 10. So the first value is the severity of the failure, with 10 being the most severe. The next value would be the occurrence or the probability that the failure will occur. And this may be different for different causes. A 1 would be that it won't occur, and a 10 would be that it's almost for sure going to occur. The final value is the probability that the failure will be detected at various stages in the product development cycle. So that would be the detection value, with 1 being very early in the product development cycle and 10 being after that product is in production. The product, or multiplying the severity value, the occurrence value, and the detection value, gives you what's called the risk priority number. So this is a number that ranges between 1 and 1,000. And the high risk priority numbers correspond to safety concerns and high customer dissatisfiers. So it's these high risk priority numbers that need to have corrective action plan associated with them. So the FMEA team would tag these, and then these items would go back to the design engineers or test engineers, who would then define a corrective action plan. So this could be a design change, a change in a part, a change in material. And after that action plan is implemented, then the design is revisited by the FMEA team, and a new risk priority number is calculated. So in a nutshell, those are the steps that that the FMEA team goes through. There are some common limitations and pitfalls that go along with FMEA. First of all, failure mode effect analysis is simply a tool. It does not correct problems in itself. It simply helps the engineers. The design engineers prioritize the risks that need to be looked at before the design can continue through the design process. Next, if an FMEA is not done completely, or if the right team isn't put together and failures exist that are outside of the experience of this team, then inputs can be overlooked and failures can be missed. And then finally, if the FMEA is started too late in the design process, where certain decisions have already been made, it can be costly and time-consuming to make design changes at that point. So if the FMEA is done early in the design process, then it's very effective at identifying failure modes and prioritizing them so that changes can be made, appropriate changes can be made. Next, it's very effective at prioritizing risk and keeping the focus on eliminating failures with high severity. And finally, failure mode effect analysis emphasizes failure prevention. For these reasons, FMEA has become an essential engineering tool in countless industries.